Now, first, as Brian has a PhD in astrophysics, we didn't think there was much we could teach him about space travel.
Well, that is until we uncovered this amazing story, untold, Brian, for 50 years, about one Briton's hidden contribution to the moon landing.
That's one small step for man.
It wasn't just the stars and stripes that were planted on the moon.
One giant leap for mankind.
This is the untold story of how a British man hijacked the first moon landing and secretly ensured that the astronauts left the Union Jack up there too.
Global TV audience of 500 million, including 8-year-old me, watched in astonishment as Neil Armstrong took one giant leap onto the lunar surface. The United States of America had won the space race, but not without a little help from a man from Nottingham.
The One Show has tracked down the engineer who reveals for the very first time a secret he's kept for 50 years and the part he played in one of mankind's greatest achievements.
My interest in space, I suppose, started when I was reading some books that my father had, which had some pictures of the moon, the way they thought at that time it would look if you were there.
Keith began making models of rockets for his school open day and eventually went on to study maths and physics. This was a time when Britain had its own space programme, so Keith joined De Havilland, the engineering company that was working on a real rocket. Designed to launch satellites, its name was Blue Streak. In 1964, Keith was sent to the launch site in Australia. Newsreel footage still exists of the work carried out there.
Have a seat.
Oh, this is going to be interesting.
That's Bill Talbot, the guy I work with, and he's just started the sequencer for the launch. So I was responsible for the safety tracking system and the engine cut system in case the vehicle went off course. This was all British.
How proud does it make you feel, Keith?
Oh, well, we were proud of it because the first stage of the whole system never failed. It was a very reliable rocket. At the time, we were significant players in launcher technology.
Keith's experience would prove invaluable. Just 3 years later, he and his young family moved to 1960s America. He had won a coveted job on the Apollo space missions. This is his own home movie footage of his time there.
At Kennedy Space Center, Keith worked as an engineer on some scientific equipment which would be left by the astronauts. He also knew that they were going to plant a Stars and Stripes flag on the moon. So Keith being Keith, well, he didn't want the British to be left out.
We were working on the experiments that the astronauts were going to put out on the lunar surface. We had Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin come to our facility, and we ran through the experiment deployment that they would do on the moon.
So you met them, and what were they like?
Neil was very, very relaxed and quite jokey. We were concentrating so hard on doing our job and making sure they could do the job properly that it almost seemed normal, but thinking about it, afterwards, I did get their signatures.
Getting their signatures gave Keith an idea.
And there were two brackets on the experiment which held the solar panels folded while travelling to the moon. We got a ball pen and signed our names. And I signed my name and I thought, well, I'll put UK. Then I thought, oh, draw a little Union flag. So we have a little Union flag sketched onto there, installed it on the experiment package and it went to the moon.
And did that flag come out before the American flag?
No.
But there is a Union Jack, a Union flag on the moon.
There is.
That is amazing. And
on Apollo 11.
You.
This is the Stars and Stripes. And this is Buzz Aldrin deploying the solar panels on the seismometer Keith engineered, whilst unwittingly planting the Union flag as well. Just about here.
Oh, wow. Thank you very much to
Keith.
Cara.
And thank you to Keith for that revelation.